But it's like for the longevity of your body, it will affect you. For the longevity of time. Piercing is part of identification factor. When we was in certain parts of the world, like they'll tell you about Mesopotamia, they'll tell you about the Middle East, they'll tell you about Africa, they'll tell you about India. What happens is you had an identification factor of the piercing. On your right hand of your nose representing 360 degrees. You had another one in your ear, the reflection of the 360. That's why you have some people that have a nose ring that attached from their ear to their nose. They're combining the sun with the moon. So what happens is, it will let you know that that 360 is talking about you as the degrees of your body, 180 and 180. With the other one, it lets you know that even though some people looked at that as a moon, you were on the tutelage of heading for 360, to eventually you would become 720. So different markings in your nose by piercing was a different identification factor on what you knew, who you were, what kind of person you were. Because a lot of people were nose ring, and that always connected with Nubian tribes. Now when it came down to the stomach with a diamond, that's blink. That's when you're in the club and you got the little tank top on your pants and you like the little tall, you know, women like them tall men, and they looking at Chris and they want him to look at that navel, and then you start looking at that navel and they got a little tattoo and they got tattoo. That's why they do what they do. That's a different school now.
Teach.
Right? That's a whole different school. That's there for attraction. I don't know. Got the little bullseye back there on the back, the 62. That's a bullseye. Oh, X marks the spot. Put it down. Y'all gonna leave that one alone, right? But identification factor, that's what the nose is supposed to be. That's what it is. Okay? Yeah.
Yeah, I want to ask about tattoos.
Okay.
So are you saying you should get
them
removed?
Hey, I don't have them. I don't know about removing. I just know that I just don't do it. I came from a different. Let me tell you something. When I was young, the only people who had tattoos were white boys and sellers.
Right.
And the sellers did it to get along. So brothers get abused because, you know, you get lynched back in them days. So you got a tattoo as a mark of you want to be accepted by the crackers, and they didn't mess with you. But the white guys had it all over their bodies. The other one that had it was a specialty, and that was the Japanese in the project that I lived in. They had it because they connected back with a group known as the Yakuza, and that was the identification of a gang. And then it became popular because I watched the bishops also get tattooed. These were brothers. They got tattoos that let you know about the gang. In so much that the other ones that was branding their bodies was fraternities.
Right.
They take a coat hanger or an iron and just put them Q signs up there or whatever. So everybody was using it to identify with their body. What happened with a lot of us is that when we became knowledgeable under, at the time, Imam Issa, the emma became our identification factor. Because we wore emmas as well as a target. And the emma let you know, with the azabah hanging down, how much you knew. So if you had a short one, but if you had one of them down there, you were stripping. But, you know, the length let you know how much. So if somebody gonna have one walking down a Juba like this, we was like, look at this big girl here. So that's to let you know how much knowledge you knew. So each one, the tattoo is an identification factor. Everything about that marking is an identification factor. That's why the Nephilim marked themselves to let you know. Because remember, out of the Nephilim, you had 200. Everybody didn't think the same. Some of them were Riskians who just sided with Zoom.
Right.
But they didn't do the stuff they was doing, like painting their bodies and their hair. So to let you know who is who, some people painted their hair yellow, some people painted their bodies, some wore silk. Shakar, what he did was he straightened, you know, he had his hair grow down long, so he would look like the finest out of them. So when you seen that long hair, you knew who it was. So everybody has something to identify. That's all it is. Tattoos are still used today as an identification factor. As I look at some got skull and bones, some got umps, some people got a whole Egyptian temple on their bodies. Some people got, you know, when you was in California, you had that tear for certain games you had. So it's an identification factor.
Just
putting it up there? See, I don't know about removing because that never happened.
Can you
get them removed?
You can.
How do you get them
laser surgery. Ooh. Numerous.
Whoa. Yeah. Not one don't get it?
No, one don't get it. You got to go back a couple of times. Ooh. So they're literally burning your skin repeatedly to have removed, so it's
going to
do just as much damage.
Right. It's a part of society, but it's something that the identification behind it. It's just the identification behind it. That's why. Good.
So that would mean that mixed in with our Cherokee Indian ancestors, black people, they got a lot of tribal tattoos to their appreciation.
But you got to ask yourself, how did that happen? Because remember, in order to get down to the Cherokee, as you call it, and the Navajo, there was a mixture of genes in there. The mix of the gene was of the Hoshin dynasty. And you got to go back and see that they were tapping in with a lot of them different markings of the body. Confucius. How did you know Confucius? And they had the big ass nails and looked like fangs and all that stuff. So you had that. And when you got that mixture, that became an identification factor. Because not all Native Americans did that.
Right.
Dark genes. How you gonna mark something black? It ain't gonna show. So the black tribe, but if you look at the ones that were a little light, there was an identification factor amongst the tribes. But they had their little conflicts too. So you had to know who was who. So they marked themselves. That's different than, you know, putting a demon up on your chest, right, on your shoulders. That's a little different. That's identifying with a whole other group.
Hey, I was reading the black book about how the Netru or the Oglaws crashed down in the Nile River.
Right. Right.
Then I also read where the Anunnaki crashed down in the Gulf.
Right.
Was that around the same time period? And
the Tia did it first. They crashed in the Nile first.
Right.
Then what we call the Anunnaki, they came later. Netru was here first. But they developed at the same time. It's just that Netru, they organized better. And their organization spread out much greater than the Sumerians. And the Sumerians, when they came in, the ideas interchanged. The greatest ideas were the Netru. So when we say who was first, who was second, I like to say they came in at the same time. Just that the Netru developed quicker. And that was more greater than the development.
So it's not like this group is agreeable and then this group is crashing.
I mean, amongst them, you had agreeable and disagreeable.
On both sides.
Right. You had some hard-headed. Because if you look at it, it's a couple hard-headed.
Right.
Then you look at the other side of the family. It depends on which way you go. Then it could be hard-headed to you, or empty, or cock a hell. Her guy was definitely the one of his.
Like you said, it depends.
But to the soldiers who wanted to kill us because of the noise, it was agreeable. Because he was helping them get rid of the problem. Agreeable, disagreeable, bad, and good is always done by people. There's really no such thing as good or bad. Because people don't have an opinion about the same situation. People make good or bad. There's no such thing as good or bad. Nature lets you know there's no such good or bad. Because you can be, I don't give a damn if you're good or bad. That rain gonna give you some water. Whether you're good or bad. So nature don't look at good or bad. We. The only reason we say good or bad is because of the effect that that situation and that person has on us becomes personal. Yeah. People say, well, the lottery is gambling. Then you finally took it. Ain't gambling no more. It's my fortune, and I'm not giving this ticket back, right? But in church, he thought, hey, gambling. It depends on who's judging the situation. That's why I like the good take that Pop has is who named God. God didn't name God. Somebody else named God. Then somebody gonna tell you about God. When they talk about God, what you think they talking about? When they talk about God, they talking about Kaloom. That's right. But you have an identification of the all. But don't get cocky, because then there's
one look in your eyes, and there I see.